Welcome viewers to the Late Jurassic, the most iconic time period of all time. Spanning 161 to 145 million years ago, this era marks the third and final epoch of the Jurassic period. And living within this time is the topic of this video, the Ceratosaurus, gaining popularity thanks to its unique horn, appropriately located along the top of the snout. This dinosaur was first discovered in 1883 and was a medium-sized theropod that lived 153 to 148 million years ago within the Late Jurassic. Whilst initially discovered within the Morrison Formation in Colorado, further dinosaur fossils of the Ceratosaurus have been discovered in places such as Wyoming, Utah, Tanzania, Portugal, and in 2020, Ceratosaurus teeth were discovered in the Tacuarembó Formation of Uruguay. Having lived in such diverse locations, we know that the Ceratosaurus was capable of surviving within many different ecosystems and habitats of the Late Jurassic. And now that we know where the Ceratosaurus lived, we can begin to analyze this apex predator. Now, whilst it is easy to look at the Ceratosaurus and draw conclusions, we first need to clarify some points of discussion. The first is the genus name of Ceratosaurus. See, when this dinosaur was first discovered in 1883 by Marshall Parker Felch, it was assigned the genus name Ceratosaurus, and the specimen was named C. nasicornis. This particular dinosaur could grow up to 17 feet in length and weighed up to 1,450 pounds. But another member of this genus, C. dentisulcatus, discovered within the Cleveland Lloyd Quarry in Utah, could grow up to 23 feet long with a maximum weight of 2,100 pounds. A third member of this genus is C. magnicornis, growing up to 13 feet in length and weighing up to 600 pounds, discovered in 1976 within Colorado. These three sizes are notably smaller than the 30-foot-long Ceratosaurus as seen in Jurassic Park, weighing in at a slim 2,200 pounds. Until further research is completed, these three members represent the various sizes that the Ceratosaurus could grow to and provide a distinct image of a tertiary consumer within its various ecosystems. That is to say that the Ceratosaurus would predate on herbivores and other smaller secondary consumers, being smaller carnivores, but the Ceratosaurus was not the apex predator of its various environments. What were the apex predators, you might ask? Keep watching and find out. And if you are enjoying the video, please like and subscribe. But first, let's address the dinosaurs that the Ceratosaurus did predate on to better understand how it behaved and what its diet might have been. Now, the Ceratosaurus inhabited three main areas. In today's world, these are the Morrison Formation of America, the Tendaguru Formation of Tanzania, and the Lorinha Formation of West Portugal. These three locations shared similar fauna and flora, despite their relative distance from one another. However, given its ease of access, the Morrison Formation remains the most catalogued and well-known location, with over 37 confirmed fauna to the present date. And so, this location will form the main focus of this video. The first dinosaur that was on the Ceratosaurus's menu was the Camptosaurus, a genus of plant-eating dinosaurs with one member, Camptosaurus dispar, growing in size up to 15 feet and weighing nearly 1,200 pounds. This puts it nearly at the same size of the Ceratosaurus. Other dinosaurs likely on the Ceratosaurus's menu includes the Ornitholestes hermani, Polaris fragilis, Frutodens hagorum, Nanosaurus, Andriosaurus altus, and Eldari, and many, many more. These dinosaurs would comprise the main bulk of a Ceratosaurus's diet, given their smaller size and lack of any real defensive weapons. But how would the Ceratosaurus actually hunt these dinosaurs? Taking a look at the Ceratosaurus, we can see that the teeth are unusually long, reaching lengths up to 3.7 inches along the upper jaw. This gives a strong impression that the Ceratosaurus would bite onto its prey and with its long teeth would inflict deep penetrations into vital organs, causing significant internal bleeding and eventual death from perhaps a single bite. However, this method of biting would also produce a substantial transfer of energy into the teeth and jaw of the Ceratosaurus. The Ceratosaurus's skull is lighter built than that of other theropods, with many openings present, most notably an enlarged lateral temporal fenestra located at the rear of the skull. Whilst reducing the overall weight of the head, this implies a certain frailness of the Ceratosaurus. With this in mind, we can assume that a Ceratosaurus would attack its prey with a single deep penetrating bite and stalk the prey as the internal bleeding takes effect, reducing risk of injury, most notably fractures, along the jaw regions. This unique jaw structure of the Ceratosaurus would disqualify it from predation on larger dinosaurs, as the elongated teeth would proportionately reduce the overall biting range, or gape, of the Ceratosaurus. Therefore, we can safely assume that this dinosaur could not hunt the many sauropods of the late Jurassic. But what other dinosaurs existed that could defend itself from a Ceratosaurus attack, you might ask? Well, living within the late Jurassic was the popular Stegosaurus and Ankylosaurus, two renowned herbivores known for their lethal spikes and bony armor. With the Stegosaurus growing up to 23 feet in length and weighing a whopping 8,200 pounds, it massively outweighs the Ceratosaurus. And looking at its spiked tail, one swing would be fatal, with deep skewering and impaling. The same, however, cannot be said of the Ankylosaur. Mimora peltomassi and Gargliosaurus parkpinorum belong to the Notosauridae family of ankylosaurs and were much smaller than the typical Ankylosaurus found in the later Cretaceous period. Being too slow to outrun their attacker, their only hope for survival would be to stay low to the ground and rely on their armored backs for protection. Although it is doubtful that this defense would work against the Ceratosaurus, which would instead deliver a lethal bite to the head and neck regions, giving thanks to an inherent size difference between the two dinosaurs. Remembering that the Ceratosaurus is a tertiary predator, its diet is not just limited to herbivores, but also other carnivores, and so would likely predate on the following meat-eating dinosaurs should they ever cross paths. Stochosaurus, Tanycolagrius, and, interestingly, there was another theropod, Marchosaurus bicentomius. This dinosaur could grow up to 20 feet in length and would have occupied the same hunting niche as the Ceratosaurus, with predation only occurring on juvenile members and not the adults between these two species. And now onto the most anticipated part of this video. What were the apex predators that dominated the landscape, and how did the Ceratosaurus compare to these top predators? Introducing the Allosaurus and the Torvosaurus, two mighty theropods known for their bite and being the top predators of the Jurassic. The first apex predator that we will analyze is the Allosaurus. Weighing in at 3,200 pounds and 28 feet in length, this dinosaur was much larger than the Ceratosaurus, even at its highest estimates. Weighing in at 3,200 pounds and 28 feet long, this dinosaur was much larger than the Ceratosaurus, even at its highest estimates. And so far, thanks to the hard work of paleontologists, we now know that there were up to 6 members of the Allosaurus genus. And looking at the Torvosaurus, 2 members of this genus existed, being Torvosaurus tanneri and Torvosaurus gunneri. Members of this genus were much larger, with T. tanneri measuring up to 30 feet and weighing 4,200 pounds, and T. gunneri measuring 36 feet and weighing a huge 9,000 pounds. The largest Ceratosaurus reached 20 feet and 1,100 pounds as a baseline for the species. Whilst it is possible that larger Ceratosaurus did exist, they would have been the exception and not the norm for the species unless new evidence says otherwise. Whilst at a clear size disadvantage, let's now compare the bite force and the relative intelligence, or lack thereof, of these dinosaurs. Let's start with brain power. This topic is much simpler as these theropods all lived in the same era and all possessed similarly evolved brains typical for theropod dinosaurs. That is to say that neither dinosaur had the edge when it came to intelligence. But now, a much more complex topic, analyzing the bite force of these dinosaurs. Due to its popularity and abundance of fossils, let's start with the Allosaurus. A common myth surrounding this dinosaur is the hatchet bite. Based off the finite element analysis in 2001 of Allosaurus fragilis, which uncovered an unusually high tolerance for vertical forces within the cranium, and combined with findings of a weaker bite force, a new method of predation was proposed, where an Allosaurus would rotate its neck to simulate a hatchet swing to increase the lethality of its bite. However, several inconsistencies are present. The first is an extreme dorsiflexion of the head and neck would be required to produce the necessary arc for the hatchet swing. The second is that the direction of impact from such an attack would require the maxilla and teeth to be orientated anteriorly like in modern great white sharks as opposed to their ventral orientation, therefore preventing the correct transfer of energy along the jaw to increase biting strength. And speaking of biting strength, the hatchet swing bite method requires a considerable gape or opening of the jaw in order to be effective. However, at such large angles, the overall bite force would be much too weak and cause serious damage to the mandible or lower jaw, not to mention breaking of teeth, due to incorrect alignment of forces generated and Allosaurus anatomy. With this out of the way, let's now break down how the Allosaurus actually would have used its bite. Taking a look at this muscle reconstruction, we can see that the temporal fenestra is narrower in Allosaurus, and the mandible is vertically deeper along the area where these muscles attach, producing vertically orientated longer muscle fibers that allow for greater jaw opening being able to reach 92 degrees wide, as one study suggests, although at the cost of a reduced bite force, with the research paper analyzing an optimum biting strength achieved at 32.5 degrees. It is estimated that the Allosaurus had a bite force ranging between 5,000 to 9,000 newtons. But this did not mean that the Allosaurus had a weak bite. Analyzing the neck muscles of Allosaurus, we can see the presence of the basitubera muscle group, as well as others, which connects to the upper cranium, and like in modern crocodiles today, is responsible for strong head decompression. After the initial bite, these muscles compress the head downwards, increasing the penetration of the upper jaw teeth, as well as locking the jaw down. This accounts for the high stress tolerance of the Allosaurus's cranium, as struggling prey would attempt to break free of the Allosaurus's bite, transferring stress forces into the Allosaurus's cranium, but at the same time inflicting self-harm as the serrated teeth of Allosaurus slice deeper into the flesh and compress harder the more the bite victim attempts to move. When facing a Ceratosaurus, the much larger Allosaurus would attempt to bite several locations, most notably the neck, belly, and thigh, whilst avoiding the front region. If successful, the Allosaurus would employ its strong neck muscles to clamp down and inflict serious lacerations onto the Ceratosaurus. However, how effective would the Ceratosaurus's bite be against the Allosaurus? Well, not very. The Ceratosaurus had a lighter built skull, meaning it wasn't suited to attacking large targets, and the proportionately longer teeth reduces the effective biting range or gape of the Ceratosaurus's jaw. A research paper published analyzed the possible bite force of several different dinosaurs and estimated that the Ceratosaurus had a bite force ranging between 2,500 to 6,000 newtons, and referring to the previous paper, by inferring from the analysis of the T-Rex, a Ceratosaurus would achieve an optimum gape at 32 degrees with a maximum of 80 degrees. On paper, these figures give the impression that the Ceratosaurus is at least comparable to the Allosaurus despite its size difference. However, in reality, size does matter, as we will soon see. The smaller size of the Ceratosaurus limits its ability to effectively bite the larger Allosaurus. Unable to leverage its jaw to inflict damage, the Ceratosaurus would leave second best when encountering a Saurus. In fact, this encounter can be seen within the fossil record. Within the Morrison Formation, areas where Ceratosaurus and Allosaurus overlapped, an observed drop in Ceratosaurus specimens was noted, with an official ratio of 7.5:1 of Allosaurus to Ceratosaurus specimens uncovered. And moving on to the Torvosaurus, being even larger than the Allosaurus, we can safely assume that an encounter would end in the same manner, with the Ceratosaurus unable to leverage its bite effectively against the larger theropod. It is unclear the exact bite force of the Torvosaurus. However, we can interpolate a likely bite strength from the formation of the skull, teeth, and overall size of the carnivore, and compare this to other estimated bite forces of other comparable dinosaurs, such as Gorgosaurus, Cyniraptor, and Daspletiosaurus. From this, it is estimated that the Torvosaurus had a bite force ranging between 7,000 newtons to 12,000 newtons, putting it above both the Allosaurus and Ceratosaurus. The Allosaurus and Torvosaurus were apex predators, and yet somehow managed to coexist, much to the dread of the Ceratosaurus, experiencing increased pressure in reduced habitats and hunting territories, showing the difficulties of being a top predator, but not the top predator of your environment. Did you enjoy this video? Comment down below what dinosaur you would like to see next, and make sure to subscribe for more content. And of course, if there's anything you did not agree with in the video, leave a comment down below. I do write the scripts on my own, and I do appreciate getting feedback. But until then, thanks for watching.